level out there is about as high as it's ever been. And I mean ever. I mean 1929, 2006, this is worse than those times. So it's very possible that the kind of crisis that comes is going to be historically unprecedented. You know, nothing we've ever seen in our lifetimes, certainly.
Insider buying is surging, and legendary investors are piling into one specific gold deal where the founders have already earned investors 500 and 900% gains on their two previous companies in the past 11 years. Insiders own 40% of the company. This is the gold play you don't want to miss out on. Learn more at crushthestreet.com/insider.
Hello, everyone, and welcome into crushthestreet.com. I am Kenneth Amanduri, and I'm joined today with John Rubino of dollarcollapse.com. And as you know, he is a voice outside of the mainstream news, speaking truth, unfiltered by propaganda. He's an author, investment advisor, and he's a returning popular favorite guest. John, thanks so much for joining me.
Hey, Kenneth. Thanks for having me back on.
As always, we love having you here. Let's start with the stock market. We've had three up days in the stock market this week. And last I checked, I do believe the stock market was up. And I read a news headline that we haven't seen 3 days in a row with the stock market being up this year in 2016, actually. So I wanted to ask you this. Is this little uptick that we're seeing a blessing for those who haven't exited some or all of their positions in the overall stock market?
We'll only know that in retrospect. There is absolutely no way in the world to predict what happens in the stock market on a week-to-week basis, because there, especially now, there is so much manipulation going on. You know, it used to be when back in the day when fundamental market movements, but now you've got all the central banks of the world intervening in stocks. You know, Switzerland is one of the biggest holders of Apple stock, for instance. The Japanese central bank owns $1 trillion worth of Japanese equities. In the U.S., you know, via the Plunge Protection Team and other entities out there, is intervening in the U.S. equity markets. So there's no way to know what happens in asset prices in the short run.
I read a Bloomberg article this morning that was titled "Why a Falling Stock Market Won't Postpone Retirements." And basically the article was saying this, I took this from the article, it says you might expect aging baby boomers to postpone their retirements anxiously after watching stocks tumble. But instead, nearly 403,000 American workers and their spouses were awarded their first Social Security checks in January, the highest monthly total in 3 years. And so my thoughts are this: maybe a falling market isn't going to stop people initially from retirement, but if it gets bad, do you see these retirees getting a rude wake-up call in the near future?
Oh, of course. You know, we've set the system up to disadvantage people who need fixed income, which is most retirees. You know, generally you save money for a lifetime and then you expect to put it away in fairly safe things like bank CDs and bond funds, have them generate income for you to live on, right? That's how retirement usually works. Well, it used to be that you could get 6 or 7% a year doing that. And that's what most retirement plans have been based on. But now you get 2% on a bank CD or whatever, and falling. And so the average would-be retiree is looking at this and wondering how they're going to eat, let alone, you know, live in general, on the money they've saved. Because you can have $1 million put away, but if you're only going to generate less than 1% on that money, that's probably not enough for you to live on. Mm. So retirees and savers in general are really being disadvantaged by current government policy of borrowing too much money and then pushing interest rates down to historically low levels to make their debts manageable. Mm. So, and another thing about that's interesting now that kind of shows how this is playing out is our employment numbers. Every month, the government reports how many new jobs were created and who got the jobs and what the jobs were. And one of the really interesting parts of that report, month after month, is that the majority of new jobs are going to people 55 and older.
Wow.
Which means that a lot of people who probably were hoping to retire are finding that they have to go back to work at least part-time to make ends meet, which makes complete sense given the math of low interest rates. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think you're seeing a lot of people delay retirement, and a lot of people come into the conclusion that they'll never retire in this kind of an environment. It'll just never happen.
You know, it's actually an example, and I've heard it put it – I didn't come up with this, so I won't take the credit, but – basically, the amount of money that people need to retire now has hyperinflated. Maybe someone would have been able to retire on $1 million, but because of this low interest rate environment, now they need $10 million. So it's an example where hyperinflation is hurting the people who want to retire, and it's just one area like that. I mean, with interest rates as bad as they are, it's not good for people who want to retire. And speaking about interest rates, John, the Fed did raise interest rates by 25 basis points in December, but the 10-year note, I mean, the yield has just been collapsing. What is it saying when the 10-year bond, the yield continues to drop in the face of the Fed trying to raise interest rates?
Well, it says something really important, which is that all the debt we've taken on for the past 30 years is profoundly deflationary. In other words, we owe so much money that too much of our current income has to go to interest payments, and a lot of that debt is going to default anyhow, giving us huge losses where we thought we had actual wealth, that the global financial system can't function without continuous infusions of new money from central banks. And the minute a major central bank like the Fed stops creating new currency and pumps, and we've seen this happen 3 or 4 times since the era of QE began, you know, they call it to taper back its money printing, the economy starts to slow down and the stock market tanks, and the Fed panics and starts a new round of liquefaction. You know, they start creating new currency and handing it to the banks again to calm the markets down. Well, we're seeing that happen now on perhaps a bigger scale because the Fed not only tapered its quantitative easing, in other words, started creating less money, it actually started shrinking the money supply. And then it raised interest rates a little bit. And so this totally spooked the markets. You know,
Well, this January was the worst 1 month start to a year in the U.S. stock market's history. So what that implies is that the markets understand that without new currency being created by the central bank and pumped into the system, that assets aren't worth what we've been paying for them. So everybody's selling everything right now except for precious metals. You know, we're getting a risk-off play with a vengeance. At least we did in January. And then they started trotting out their talking heads to make the markets feel better. And there's this one guy, Bullard, who they used for a while as their voice of conservative reason. You know, he was the guy that they trotted out in the last couple of years saying, hey, we should raise interest rates. it's time because the economy might be growing too fast and we need to raise rates, blah, blah, blah. And now they brought him back out to say, nah, you know what, we're data dependent and the data has turned in a negative direction, so we shouldn't raise interest rates after all. So the markets responded to that by going up for a few days. But the way it works with the Fed fooling the markets in this way is that when a Fed talking head says something, traders immediately go out and buy stuff. You know, they act the way the Fed wants them to act. But then over the next 2 or 3 days or 2 or 3 weeks or whatever the time frame is in any given instance, people figure out that the Fed didn't actually do anything. They just said some stuff, and that the world isn't actually in very good shape. You know, we've got problems everywhere we look, and it's being reflected in the earnings of corporations and the yield on junk bonds and many other things that are very scary. So they go back to selling again. And markets are down again this morning. You know, after 3 really nice up days, it's starting to roll over a bit. Precious metals are up and stocks are down again. And so what is going to happen in the not too distant future is that these guys who are talking like Mario Draghi, who's the head of the European Central Bank, who periodically comes out and says a variation of, we'll do whatever it takes. And the U.S. Fed that now is walking back its interest rate threats in order to calm the markets down. These guys will actually have to do something at some point, which is to say they've got to come up with some new kind of monetary experiment that isn't just the old stuff that they've done that failed. You know, you can't cut interest rates to negative 1% if cutting interest rates from 6% to 0 didn't work. You know, why would one more cut into negative territory produce a quote-unquote normal economy that grows organically without the need for continuous infusions of new cash? It won't happen. So 2016 and 2017 will be periods of extreme monetary experimentation, because that's the only way to keep the system from imploding. And it probably won't work, but they'll try it because they have no alternative to just standing back and letting the system implode. You know, if you just look at the numbers, you would infer that we have a 1930s-style debt-driven deflationary depression on our hands. And that is indeed what we would have if the central banks of the world didn't keep creating new currency and pushing interest rates down. So these guys have no choice. They can't just stand back because the system will fall apart. So they got to try something. So this year and next year, we'll get some variation of a debt jubilee where governments just give you money and ask you to pay off your debts, but not really police that. Or the war on cash, where they make interest rates negative, and then they make cash either really inconvenient to use or flat out illegal to force us all into electronic accounts where they can push interest rates down and in that way tax us, you know, because a negative interest rate is, in effect, a tax. So things like that are going to happen, plus various kinds of capital controls where they don't let you move your money out of the country in response to their mismanagement, you know, and that's already in the early stages of happening in Europe and in China and to an extent in the U.S., and we're going to see it become explicit in the next year or two. So we're embarking on a new phase of monetary experimentation that's going to be even crazier than the last couple of versions and probably a lot more destructive. You know, if it buys us a little bit of time, you know, if the markets go up a little bit in response to it, that will just lead to even more debt being taken on and a bigger bust out there in the future. So we're buying a bigger crisis in the future by avoiding whatever crisis we would have now if we just get out of the way and let it happen.
Now, I think the global citizen, just someone that's a part of this world that is part of that debt jubilee, they're going to like the idea of something like that. It's going to sound good, not understanding the unintended consequences. Would you agree with that, John?
Well, people like free stuff, and we've been trained to think the government is going to take care of us. So to the extent that the government comes back and says, oh, yeah, from now on, your college loans are gone. You know, we're going to eliminate them, and we're going to make college free in the future, and we're going to give you some money to pay off your other debts. So you can pay that car off or pay off most of your mortgage or whatever. Oh, people will love that at first. But the tiny fraction of the global financial system that actually understands the implications of something like that will jump with both feet into real assets. You know, people will start buying farmland and oil wells and gold and silver and anything you can buy that governments can't just create more of on an electronic printing press, you will buy. And if that gains enough momentum to actually be consequential in the world, then it'll be the Austrian economics crack-up boom, where everybody starts converting their currency, which they no longer trust, into real stuff and driving the prices of those real things up to inflationary levels. You know, you get, in effect, a hyperinflation, but what you really are seeing is a loss of faith in the currency. So that's a possibility when the next stage of the experiment starts.
John, let's talk about oil prices. Yeah, and I know you've done some research on it. It's essentially an effect of this global market meltdown. But let's get your initial thoughts on what we're seeing with oil and the economy.
Well, oil is a part of the commodities complex. And across the board, commodities were bid up by China, borrowing basically more money than any country has ever borrowed in the last 5 years to build out their infrastructure. So they bought oil because they were adding new cars and new roads and new airports, and they bought iron ore and copper and, you know, you name the commodity, they bid the price of it way up because they bought so much of it. And now they basically run out of steam. You know, they borrowed all they can borrow. They misspend a lot of it, and so they've had to scale back their infrastructure build-out, and so demand for commodities has plunged. Now, oil is part of that story, but at the same time, China was doing its thing. The U.S., via fracking technology, was opening a new front in the global oil market by producing more oil than most other countries. We became the biggest oil producer in the world over the last few years, thanks to fracking. Mm-hmm. Now, Saudi Arabia, who is the victim of that, decided that they're just not going to take it. You know, so they aren't going to see the price of their main source of foreign exchange revenue plunge and allow these U.S. frackers to continue to grow, continue to make more profit, and continue to reinvest in ever greater production. So they allowed the price of oil to plunge by not scaling back their production. And so they're trying to put the frackers out of business here. And so right now it hasn't worked yet because a lot of oil wells take a long time to get going. And so we're seeing the production now that was contracted for several years ago come online, and we're still producing, even at these lower prices, way more than the world is demanding.
Why is that?
And, well, because there's a lot of momentum built into an industry like oil, where even if the price goes down, if you've got this brand new well that you put $1 billion into, and it's going to start producing now, you don't want to just close the well down because you lose everything. So what you do is you produce and sell that oil for whatever you can get for it and hope that it covers your marginal cost at least. Mm. In other words, it'll cover the cost of getting that oil out of the ground today. It just won't cover your debts. Mm. And so the result is a bloodbath in the junk bond market, where a lot of these new facilities and new wells were financed. And a series of bankruptcies in the oil patch, but that's a while away. You know, that it's getting going now, but it won't really hit for another 6 months or a year. And in the meantime, a lot of these guys are going to continue to produce, and maybe even after they go bankrupt, because going bankrupt basically means you're not paying your debts anymore, but you still got this asset,
right?
And or somebody still has the asset, and they're maybe just going to keep pumping. Mm-hmm. And so what happened in the last week that got the oil markets a little excited was that Saudi Arabia and Venezuela and a couple of other countries got together and decided that they would cap production at current rates, which sounds good until you realize that current rates are record level production. Mm-hmm. So, and meanwhile, Iran, which was kept off the oil markets for a few years by sanctions, is now coming back into the market, and they want their old market share.
Right.
So they're not going to scale back production. So the deal that's been announced, which is a freeze in production by several big producers, means nothing to the supply imbalance. You know, there's still way too much being produced, and we're running out of storage space. So, you know, in and of itself, what has been announced lately will not fix the imbalance in the oil market, and so we might see another crack in price. It's very possible we could see it go from, you know, $31 or whatever it is today down into the mid to low 20s, and that would probably blow up the junk bond market. So, you know, there are a lot of things that can go wrong in the global financial system, and oil is one of them. You know, the junk bond market is looking like a, you know, the subprime mortgage market of 2005, 2006, where it's not blowing up yet, but it's on the verge of blowing up. And when it goes, it's billions of dollars.
Now, isn't the solution to the supply issue, the oversupply issue, and essentially low prices? I mean, when there are low prices, companies lose money, and eventually they have to stop production because these companies go out of business. So eventually, won't the free market correct this? Or do you see that happening, or is it going to take some time?
Oh, sure. No, you're right. Low prices will take enough supply off the market and pump up enough demand to bring things back into balance. The question is, what happens between now and then? And probably we get a lot of junk bonds defaulting, which hurt the banks who own the junk bonds and the retirees. You know, these poor people who've been pushed into junk bond mutual funds because their bank CDs don't yield anything. Now they're the ones who are going to suffer from this mainly. And then a lot of pension funds that need 7 or 8% returns year after year after year to make their obligations. They've been stepping out further and further on the risk spectrum, and part of that has been with junk bonds. Well, they're all going to suffer from this. So we're going to see dislocations in different parts of the financial markets on the way, and then a lot of oil companies are just flat out going to go bankrupt. So the people who bought those stocks hoping for a good dividend yield, again, same thing. Your CD doesn't pay you anything. Therefore, you ask your financial advisor to give you some dividend stocks. Well, a lot of those dividend stocks are going to tank now. So it won't be a painless process of adjustment. It's going to be a process through which the old capacity is taken off the market via bankruptcy and default. And at the same time, a lot of the countries that are oil exporters, like Saudi Arabia and Russia, are seeing their finances deteriorate at an accelerating rate. And they're having to dump treasury bonds on the open market right now, which so far hasn't been a problem, but might be at some point in the future. So it's going to be extremely messy, and that's just one thing. You know, oil is one of 10 different things that are at historically dangerous levels right now. And so, you know, there's no way to know whether they blow up sequentially or all at once or only a couple of them blow up. You can't know that ahead of time, but you can say with certainty that the risk level out there is about as high as it's ever been, and I mean ever. I mean 1929, 2006, this is worse than those times. So it's very possible that the kind of crisis that comes is going to be historically unprecedented. You know, nothing we've ever seen in our lifetimes, certainly.
John, let's transition over to precious metals. And I think the last time we were talking and did an interview, we were in a bear market. I think most people would consider what we were seeing in the precious metals arena a bear market. And it's hard to say that we're in a bull market, but we've seen an uptick for sure in precious metals since our last discussion. So I'd like to ask you, what component of the precious metals thesis triggered this uptick in precious metals?
Well, three things happened. One is precious metals just went down a long way. You know, when something falls dramatically, it tends to eventually bottom and go back up. You know, so for just purely technical reasons, precious metals were getting towards the bottom. The second thing is that precious metals are what you hide out in during a crisis. And beginning with the fourth quarter of 2015 and emphatically continuing into January of 2016, people were thinking in terms of crisis. You know, things were starting to go wrong, and so it became reasonable to cash out some of your Google or your Apple stock and buy some gold and silver, right? So that gave gold and silver a slight pop, not a huge one, but, you know, $100 on gold or whatever, which is nice to see. The third thing for the mining sector, this is where it gets even more interesting. Plunging oil prices actually lower the costs of mining gold and silver because, you know, you got to run these big earth-moving machines, and they run on diesel fuel generally. So that lowered the costs of miners just as gold and silver were starting to go up a bit. And so all of a sudden, you've got some profitable gold and silver miners out there who have just been crushed. You know, their prices of their stock have plunged lately. And so suddenly, they're both value plays and momentum plays. So they show up on a lot of different screens. and they're starting to really pop. You know, I've got a screen up now of a precious metals portfolio, and there's a lot of double-digit and near double-digit increases today, and there have been for the previous month. And so now people are starting to get excited because they're stock. Gold and silver miners are starting to become momentum plays, you know, and that's the excitable money, you know, that is, oh, this is moving, let me buy some. You know, they don't even, momentum traders generally don't even think about the nature of the business they're buying into. They just assume that if something is soaring, there are fundamental reasons for that, so let's ride that trend, you know, and so all of that is combining to make precious metals behave in a way that gold bugs haven't seen for a few years. You know, it's really welcome change.
Mm-hmm.
And will it continue? Who knows? But it's nice to experience while it's happening.
John, let's stay on that for a minute here. And I'll ask you this. Is it going to take some time for the big money to enter the precious metal sector? And the big money would need to see some established uptrend for that to happen, I would assume. I know we're seeing some movements in the precious metals arena. So I would assume that they would also need a higher precious metals price so a lot of these miners, or more of them, can be significantly profitable and stop losing money. So is there a gold price that you see us hitting that would trigger the influx of buying and therefore the full force of the bull market?
I have absolutely no idea what big money managers are thinking because you know, it seemed unreasonable to me for the last few years to be buying equities, you know, general equities, which were already kind of high-priced, and selling precious metals, which were getting historically cheap. You know, it just didn't seem to make sense what was going on in terms of capital flows. So I think at some point, markets will get excited by a story in precious metals that combines value and growth and momentum, and that you'll see a lot of institutional money flowing in. But when that is, who knows? You know, it's impossible to say. But I tell you what, when it comes, the imbalance between the amount of financial wealth that's out there, wealth quote unquote, and the amount of precious metals that are available, if you want to start converting stocks and bonds and cash into precious metals, is immense. You know, gold and silver are tiny little markets compared to the bond market and the stock market, the amount of cash that exists in the world. So let 1% of global financial wealth flow into precious metals, and these things would be a rocket. You know, they would just take off because there just isn't that much metal. And so I think that eventually has to happen. And it has to happen on a bigger scale than 1%. I mean, it wouldn't be unreasonable to see 5 or 10% of global financial wealth move into precious metals-related things at the peak of the next cycle. And when that happens, you know, $5,000 gold and $100 silver are very easy to envision.
Mm.
Now, whether we get another crack in the price and they go back down to historic lows before that, that's possible. You know, there's no way to know. But I think you need to keep your eye on that prize, you know, the huge phase shift in the attitude of the financial markets that is coming eventually. And don't let what happens in the meantime rattle you too much, because you know this big thing is out there, and it'll happen, and we can't say when, but you know what? If it takes 10 years to happen, that's still not bad. If you're on that side of things, you'll be glad you were.
Mm. Well, well said, John. You know, and to be honest with you, I think we're ready to conclude because you wrapped it up in a very, very good way, and you shared a lot of information with us that, you know, I'm going to be chewing on probably for the next week, to be honest with you. But is there anything else, if you didn't get to it or wanted to say before we got on this call, had on your mind, please share it with us, and of course let everyone know where they can find you and reach out to you and follow your work.
Okay. There's one more side to the story, which is that financial crisis usually leads to political and geopolitical crisis. In other words, when the economy stops working, governments start looking for enemies abroad, and they get into fights that are really designed to distract their voters from their own mismanagement. And political parties and candidates that you wouldn't normally see as that mainstream start getting mainstream level votes, and that's happening all over the world now. You know, Europe has all these formerly fringe parties that are either leading or contending in a lot of polls and elections now, and in the U.S. you've got Bernie Sanders and avowed socialists getting as many votes as Hillary Clinton, the establishment candidate, and you've got Donald Trump, who was seen as a circus clown by most Republican insiders a year ago, now looking like the presumptive nominee, you know, and so that's part of the process. It's all part of the financial crisis story, and so we shouldn't be surprised by it, but we should be very, very worried by it. And for more on this, dollarclaps.com is the site that I run that basically tracks this stuff on a day-to-day basis.
John Rubino, everyone, of dollarcollapse.com. John, it's always a pleasure to talk to you, and thank you again for coming on and sharing your research with us today.
Thanks, Kenneth.